Again, welcome everybody, and I will give today's talk on high intensity outbound solid state lasers and development of Perla in this platform at HiLase facility. In the beginning, I would shortly introduce HiLase Center. Then I will switch to some overview of our ultra short pulse lasers at HiLase and development of the platform based on ytterbium for generation of 1 micron picosecond pulses. I will also show some results of frequency conversion. That means we can convert our ultra short pulses to visible or mid-infrared spectra range. And I will finish the talk with introduction of our commercial platform we are offering and customization options for such a laser system and example of some interesting applications we can do with our thin disk lasers. Where we are, the HiLase Center is located very close to Prague. You can see the Prague is in the center of the Czech Republic, and our facility is very close to south border of the city of Prague. We are part of the scientific science and technology region called STAR, and we are surrounded by several very famous technological companies and scientific institutes. The HiLase Center is part of the Institute of Physics of Czech Academy of Sciences, and it was established almost 10 years ago, like a center for providing support of industry and industry applications in development of dark pump solid state lasers with breakthrough parameters like the goal was to reach average powers higher than 1 kW, ultra short pulses, very high pulse energy. HiLase Center connects three, or it's based on three pillars. One of them is laser development. The lasers are tailored to application. Then we have a group of experimentalists who are developing new breakthrough laser applications and actually provide feedback for laser development. And then we have a group of theoreticians supporting the two other pillars. So this is a photo of our facility. The building was built between 2012 and 2014. We have more than 700 square meters of laboratories, experimental halls, and clean rooms. And from 2015, the laser is fully working and developing the laser systems and laser applications. We are surrounded, as I said, by many many technological companies. We created a network of industrial companies like Japanese Gigaphoton, Rigaku, local companies from automotive like Škoda, optical companies Kreaturme Opta, and we also have many collaboration with scientific institutes from all over the world, from Europe, from Asia, South Korea, Japan, United States. So now let's switch to the lasers, to the laser itself. Apologize. Our lasers are based on so-called technology of thin disk. That's a way how to reach high average power approaching 1 kW or exceeding even 1 kW. Unlike the bulk lasers, which are quite usual, the configuration of rod, which is a gain or acts like a gain medium in laser. We use this kind of like very thin rod with a large size. The diameter can exceed 1 centimeter, or it can reach even 2-3 centimeters in some cases of high energy. The typical thickness of our disk is in hundreds of microns, unlike the rod, which usually has several centimeters. And the advantage of such kind of geometry is following. So we can efficiently cool the medium. Yeah, you can see if the disk is directly attached to a heatsink, we have large size cooling of the gain medium. The ratio of the thickness and the diameter is very large, and we can efficiently extract all the heat from the very thin gain medium. Other advantage is a low thermal lensing. If you take whichever gain medium, the laser beam creates thermal gradient in the gain medium. The highest temperature is in the center, and such a gradient creates a thermal lens in the medium, which worsens the laser parameters and actually limits the achievable average power from the laser system. This is not case of a thin disk structure. So here we have axial heat flow, unlike the laser rod, where the heat flow is usually in radial direction. And the influence of the thermal lensing is very low. Other advantage is very low nonlinearity of the gain medium. Yeah, because of the small thickness, the single pass induced nonlinearity is extremely low, and the total V integral describing this nonlinearity is below one, or significantly below one. This configuration also has one disadvantage, which is low single pass gain. It's given by the small thickness again. So what we need to do is to realize somehow multiple passes of both the pump beam for the laser system and the signal beam as well. Yeah, so then we can somehow reach 90% or more, 90% of absorption of the pump beam, and also high gain for the signal itself. To do this, we have a special optical system, like you can see on the left side. So first, the thin disk gain medium is placed in such a system like an active mirror. So that means the back side of the disk is HR coated, the front side is anti-reflection coated, and this active mirror is directly attached to a heatsink. Yeah, the heatsink can be either a diamond or sapphire or some kind of highly thermally conductive material, and is directly water cooled from the backside by a water nozzle. Then we have a parabolic mirror in front of the thin disk and a set of several prisms. So it's a typical structure which allows us to multiple the number of passes of the pump radiation through the thin disk. It can be typically from 24 to 50 passes of the pump beam through the gain medium, and so we can efficiently store the energy in the gain medium. And then there is a hole in the parabolic mirror, so in a normal incidence to the thin disk is coming the signal beam, which is amplified in case of CW laser. You would have end mirror of the cavity. For amplification of ultra short pulses, we usually use a structure of regenerative amplifier, which allows for efficient amplification of signal pulses by many cavity passes. So the pulse is locked in a laser cavity, and after 50, 60, 70, or more passes is again ejected, and all the energy from stored in the gain medium is transferred to the laser pulse itself. As I said, if you want to build an efficient laser system, it must be diode pumped. So all our laser systems are diode pumped, and we also use the same kind of pumping very successfully for the thin disk gain media. Because our thin disk lasers are usually based on ytterbium-YAG crystals, the wavelength we can use for pumping of the gain medium is either 940 nanometers or 969. So these are absorption lines of ytterbium-YAG. The line around 940 nanometers is broader. However, the line around 969 nanometers is better for pumping. It's narrower, but it's better. So that means we need to use very narrow band high power diodes for pumping directly to this line. The diodes are usually volume break rating stabilized. And the reason why we use pumping at this very narrow line is that we are closer to signal wavelength. The signal wavelength is 1030 nanometers. And if we calculate the losses, the quantum defect, which characterizes the amount of heat which is actually wasted in the gain medium. So in case of pumping at so-called zero phonon line at 969 nanometers, the amount or the quantum defect is only 6% or close to 6%. So we save 3%, or the quantum defect is 3.5% lower than for pumping at 940 nanometers. And we can reach higher average power actually, because we can afford pumping at higher average power, and then also the output is higher. We proved the advantages of this kind of pumping also by experiments internally, and we also found other interesting effect that for the pumping at 940 nanometers, the rise of the disk surface temperature is nonlinear. The rise is much faster than for pumping at 969 nanometers when the temperature rise is linear. So especially for high power lasers, this is really significant amount of heat, and also it explains why we can reach the breakthrough parameters from the point of view of average power from our disk lasers. So the table on the right side shows that actually with the standard pumping at 940 nanometers, the limit for the laser power was around 90 watts. With the new kind of pumping, we are able to reach 130 watts, which is 40 watts more than the standard one. So currently, all of our lasers are pumped by this kind of improved laser diodes. To support customization of our lasers and commercialization, we are also developing components for construction of thin disk lasers. So as I said, you need a special optical system to efficiently pump the thin disk. And then the development or the results of the development you can see on some of these figures. So we are developing a series of thin disk heads ranging from several watts to several kilowatts of achievable pump power for the laser head. So the standard one you can see here, it's for pumping up to approximately 1 kilowatt of pump power. And then If the average output power we can get to several hundreds of watts in signal beam. We are also developing some larger thin disk heads, allowing pumping up to several kilowatts, and then also output average power could reach really 1 kilowatt. This photo is from laboratory testing, so it's not the final product, whereas this one is final product. We are also developing, for example, large size Pockels cells, which are essential for construction of laser amplifiers with ultra short pulses. And we are also developing the thin disk gain media. It's a very tricky technology to really make the gain medium, which actually could survive very high working temperatures, which can reach more than 100 degrees of centigrade. And actually, it must be also mechanically very stable in order to reach a high beam quality, which our lasers definitely have. And also, it must have a quite long lifetime. So, yeah, so these are some results of our development. And yeah, currently we have very good results in the laboratory, and soon we will have our own in-house technology, which will support the development of commercial lasers. I would mention some like key advantages or key parameters of our solid state lasers. So our Perla platform reaches excellent beam quality described by M square parameter, which is typically less than 1.2, more often 1.1 at this moment. We can reach very high average power at this moment up to 600 watts, but we are working on upgrade up to 1 kilowatt in picosecond pulses. The pulse energy, which is currently available from our system, is up to 50 millijoules, but again, some upgrades are planned. And if you recalculate such values to peak power, we can reach more than 13 gigawatts. This is an example for 20 millijoule pulses, 1 kilohertz repetition rate, and 1.5 picosecond long pulses. Typically, from ytterbium-ya gate media, we can get pulses shorter than 2 picoseconds. Again, typical pulse duration is closer to 1 picosecond. It's between 1.2 and 1.4 picosecond. And because of very good focusability of the laser beams, we can also reach very high peak power densities, exceeding 10 to 16 watts per centimeter square. Yeah, in fact, we can later customize the parameters. We are limited by average power, which is given by the pulse energy and repetition rate. So the higher repetition rate, the lower pulse energy, and peak power then is given like a ratio of pulse energy and pulse duration. At this moment, we are operating several laboratory demonstrators of the Perla platform. The pulse energy ranges from 1 joule, and this is especially for scientific applications, to 1 millijoule or even lower. The lower energy is maybe more beneficial for industrial applications. Also, the beamline have different repetition rate. The most energetic one should reach 1 joule per pulse. The demonstrator Perla B can reach currently 20 millijoules in continuous pulsed operation, or we are also working on burst operation. In burst mode, we can reach at this moment around 37 millijoules per pulse in the burst, and totally in the burst 370 millijoules in picosecond pulses. And then we have our workhorse, the Perla C beamline. It currently reaches 600 watts, and we are working on upgrade to 1 kilowatt. And the repetition rate typical for the application is from 50 to 100 kilohertz, which is very, very useful for many applications. But also the repetition rate can be customized especially for the beamlines Perla B and Perla C. We can also do conversion to harmonic frequencies from second to fifth, so we can cover the range from UV to visible, and we can do also frequency conversion to mid-infrared spectra range, currently from 1.6 to 3 microns in wavelength. It's realized by optical parametric amplifiers. Lately, we also started with development of beamlines emitting at microns. These beamlines are again based on thin disk geometry, and thin disk gain medium consisting of holmium yag or other holmium based materials. So the plan for this beamline is to reach tens or hundreds of millijoules at microns and high average power in the future. I would very briefly describe the currently scientific beamlines Perla A and Perla B, just to provide a full overview, and then I would switch to the Perla B and Perla C, which are better for industrial applications. The scientific beamline Perla A is based on cryogenically cooled gain media. That means we used liquid nitrogen for cooling of ytterbium yag crystals. It consists of several amplifiers. What is most important is we currently have first power preamplifier, which reaches 100 millijoules in 4 picosecond long pulses. It's a multipass system. And the pulses from this amplifier will be soon seeded to a final amplifier, which will boost the pulses to 1.5 joules. The 1.5 joules should be reached before compression, so there will be also pulse compressor. And finally, the expected pulse energy is 1 joule in 4 picosecond long pulses. And there are some nice figures from the Perla A. So the beam quality is around 1.2. This is near field profile of the laser beam and far field. And you see we can reach more than 100 millijoules from this preamplifier. The photo shows the cryostat, which is used for cooling of the laser crystal. Application of this beamline is primarily scientific at this moment. It's especially of generation of X-rays from laser-induced plasma. Here you see that maybe in the future it's better to use longer wavelengths, like our beamlines working at 2 microns for more efficient generation of X-ray photons, or other direct application is generation of X-ray photons by Compton scattering on relativistic electrons. But it's a bit further from our applications we should describe today. Then in one slide, I will again very briefly describe the Perla D. It's our laser system based on holmium yag. So here you can see an example of holmium yag thin disks. It's a system with a fiber-based front end, thin disk booster amplifier, and in the future we are planning to add 2 more amplifiers to boost the pulse energy and average power. Yeah, so currently we are targeting at 10 millijoule of pulse energy at least. If everything goes well, then 100 millijoules. And the primary application for such a laser system is laser-induced damage threshold measurement of optical coatings, then some X-ray generation again, processing of polymers, plastics, some LIDARs, and there are plenty of other applications for mid-infrared laser beams, but it's probably beyond this webinar. Also for such a laser system, we are modifying the components because if we use other laser material, we need to modify the number of passes of the pump beam, signal beam, and so on. Also we can provide the components for 2-micron lasers. Now let's switch to Perla B system. So our laboratory demonstrator consists of several amplifiers again, which are called Perla B20, 100, or 500. So it should the number should describe the final average power we are targeting at. The Perla B20 is routinely used for industrial applications and high lays. We are working on increase of the pulse energy, and we are also working on the multi-pass amplifier, which would increase the pulse energy at high repetition rate. Currently, we are testing the amplifier in a burst mode. It's a burst of 10 laser pulses. We reached 37 millijoule per pulse in the burst, and the intra-burst pulse repetition rate is 10 kilohertz. So for 10 pulses in the burst, we can reach 370 millijoules. Yeah, to show some schematic of the system, so we have this Perla B20 used for amplification up to 20 millijoules. I would like maybe to emphasize what I haven't said yet, that our laser systems are based on so-called shared pulse amplification system. So that means we have a small oscillator. We stretch the pulses in the beginning in order not to damage any components in the main amplifier. We amplify the stretched picosecond pulses, usually in a regenerative amplifier or to higher energy in multipass amplifier. And we compress the pulses again to original pulse duration. So this system we use for amplification to 20 millijoules, for energy tens of millijoules or hundreds in the future. We are planning to use multipass geometry when no laser cavity is used. It's just geometrical multiplexing of the signal beams to reach higher output pulse energy. So this is how the output pulse burst can look like. Yeah, so you see 10 pulses with intra-burst repetition rate of 10 kilohertz. And currently the goal is 100 millijoule per pulse for the multipass amplifier. The regenerative amplifier can work continuously with repetition rate of 1 kilohertz. These are some photos of our system. Yeah, so it's like a first prototype of this Perla B 20. The pulse duration is below 1.7 picosecond typically, and power stability of this laboratory demonstrator 0.5%. Pulse to pulse energy stability is slightly worse, but also very good, and the same beam quality. So here you can see the near field beam profile of the laser itself. Yeah, for the multipass amplifier, we need to have, because I said we are realizing spatial multiplexing of the beams in the multipass amplifier. So we have an array of mirrors without laser cavity, and this is something which is still under development at high lays and in the future will provide higher pulse energy. Some graph currently with the multipass amplifier, we can reach efficiency approaching 25%, and this is not the latest results. Currently we have 370 millijoules and not 220, so we are gradually increasing the pulse energy from Perla B. This beamline is also equipped with harmonic frequency conversion. Besides the fundamental wavelength at 1 or 1030 nanometers, we provide second harmonic, which is 515 nanometers. It's a green light. We use LBO crystal for conversion, and the conversion efficiency is around 60%. So up to now, we were able to reach 5 millijoules from the regenerative amplifier with 1 kilohertz repetition rate and pulse duration close to 1 picosecond. Under construction on this beamline is frequency conversion to third harmonic and fourth harmonic, which is in UV spectra region. So this is beam profile at 100 watt for fundamental and for second harmonic. Finally, we have the high average power, high repetition rate beamline. As I said, so again, we have several laboratory demonstrators ranging from 100 watt to 1 kilowatt. This was the starting point for development of our commercial lasers, which we are producing at this moment. Again, it's a system based on Chirp pulse amplification. So we have a simple fiber-based oscillators and several preamplifiers. The details are not important at this moment. Just what is important, we stretch the pulses close to 1 nanosecond, and we amplify the pulses again in a thin disk based regenerative amplifier to 1 millijoule or several millijoules, depending on the kind of laser system. The advantage of this regenerative amplifier definitely is very good beam quality. As I already showed, we can reach 1.1 m square parameter. That's thanks to the cavity, which is in the laser system and forms a very good mode profile. Then the amplifier is switched by a focus cell. It plays a role of optical switch. So when the high voltage on the focus cell is switched on, the pulse is being amplified. And after switching of the voltage, it's again ejected. And after amplification, the pulse is compressed in either Chirp volume regulating compressor, which can be very tiny and very easy to align. And it's a very robust solution. On the other hand, it's not suitable for average power higher than 50 watts. So for higher average power, we use standard diffraction gratings for pulse compression. The footprint of the laser system itself, without any other equipment like pulse pickers and so on, can be very small. It's smaller than 0.9 by 1.2 square meters. As I said, we use ytterbium-YAG gain medium in the cavity of the laser system, and very compact compressors. So all these equipment can have a footprint only 0.9 by 1.2 meters. This structure can amplify to 1 millijoules at 100 kilohertz. So average power is 100 watt with very good power stability. If 1 millijoule is not enough at 100 kilohertz, we can amplify the pulses more in a regenerative amplifier with a ring cavity. And then the output pulse energy can exceed 10 millijoules at 50 kilohertz or 5 millijoules at 100 kilohertz. Although the cavity is very long, more than 6 meters, the footprint is again very small. It's very compact laser, 1.2 meter by 0.8 meters again, without additional equipment. And we can reach very high efficiency. We can approach 50% optical efficiency, which is very high for solid state lasers. And depending on the repetition rate, the average power can reach up to 550 watts. The system is very stable, and Yeah, the beam quality 1.4, which I'm showing here, is for full power. So that means average power approaching 500 watts. If the laser is operated at 1 or 200 watts, the beam is significantly better. Yeah, so there are some photos of the laboratory demonstrator of our Perlasi, and the typical results we can reach with the Perlasi resonative amplifier. So that means 550 watts, which is, this is output power, and optical efficiency, that means a conversion of the pump photons to signal photons, is almost 45%. Then the real efficiency is lower, because you also need to calculate the efficiency of semiconductor pump laser and power supplies and so on. Yeah, again, here in this laser we can convert the output beam, which is here, to second harmonic in LBO crystal, or to third harmonic. The third harmonic is some frequency of the second harmonic and the fundamental. And we can also do fourth harmonic, which is like doubling first in the LBO to second harmonic, and second in BBO or CLBO to fourth harmonic. And we can also do fifth harmonic, like some frequency of the fourth one and the fundamental one in CLBO. So we can cover very broad spectra range. Sure that the higher harmonic, the lower average output power and the worse beam quality. So at second harmonic, we are able now to offer 90 watts average power in picosecond pulses, repetition rate 50 or 100 kilohertz. At third harmonic, the average power is around 40 watts, 100 or 50 kilohertz. And in UV at four harmonic, 258 nanometers, we are around 20 watts. And finally, fifth harmonic, the average power is very low, because this is technologically very, very challenging. And also the beam quality is not so good, but this is really UV light, 206 nanometers. So below you can see typical beam profiles at this moment from laboratory demonstrators. Yeah, the commercial grade lasers, which are like the next level in the development, have even better beam profiles. However, at four harmonic, we are limited by the poor quality of the conversion crystals at this moment, but we are working on improvement. And at the end of the laser description, I would show also the possibility to convert our beams to mid-infrared spectra range, so we can cover the range from approximately 1.7 microns to currently not 2.6 but 3.2 microns. This conversion system is based on optical parametric amplifier, which is like extension of our Perlasi platform. First, we generate the signal in this mid-infrared spectra region. So it's at a wavelength ranging from 1.7 to 1.95. And we amplify the output an optical parametric amplifier, which is pumped by our Perla system. So in the system, we use periodic Lipor lithium niobate crystals and KTP crystals for amplification. To increase the stability of the output and broaden the tunability, we've lately upgraded the system. So the signal generation is based on supercontinuum generation with a small preamplifier based on BBO crystals. And finally, we again amplifying by KTA crystals in a spectral range from 1.45 to 3.5 microns. So here you can see the tunability of the front end, the supercontinuum generation stage, which is from 680 to 800 nanometers, and the tunability of the final amplifier, which is the spectral range is really very broad, and the output pulses are shorter than 2 picoseconds again, repetition rate typically 100 kilohertz. And average power we can reach. This is only the first stage of that amplifier. It's in milliwatts, but the final amplifier can reach more than 8 watts in a signal beam. Signal beam is from 1.7 to 1.9 microns, and more than 5 watts in so-called idler beam, which is from 2.18 to 3.2 microns. So again, here you can see the tunability of the signal beam and the idler beam and total average power at the output of the laser system. So not all the wavelengths can be generated with the same efficiency. If you are at the edges of the spectral range, the average power is lower, and the pulse energy as well. Yeah. Finally, I would show some beam profiles at the output of this amplifier. So this is the so-called signal beam between 1.5 and 2 microns, and this is the idler beam beyond 2 microns of wavelength. So the beam quality is again very good, and yeah, the total output signal, which depends on the wavelength, so it's different for different wavelengths, but it exceeds usually 8 watts in total. And pulse duration 1.3 picoseconds, repetition rate given by the Perla platform. Currently, we are developing the system also like extension of for our commercial laser platform, Perla laser platform, which I will show in following slides, and we will be able also to offer this extension commercially and customized for the needs of experimentalists. The platforms, especially the Perla B and Perla C, are excellent tool, for example, for surface functionalization. It's something what we are developing here. We have a group of experimentalists working on this kind of technological applications. And what is it, surface functionalization? So we are inspiring in nature, for example, structures like lotus leaf, shark skin, or insect eyes can be an inspiration for creation of micro or nanostructures. With better or changed surface properties, we can make super hydrophobic structures, we can change the friction of the surfaces, we can make anti-fogging surfaces, and so on and so on. So there are plenty of applications, plenty of structures we can make on the surface of many materials by the Perla platform we are developing. So I can show an example of hydrophobic surfaces which were created by our Perla laser here at HiLase, and some microscope view of such structures with 50 microns resolution. Why the picosecond pulses are so good for such application? Here you can see the difference. If you use nanosecond laser, the accumulated heat in the material is much higher. You can observe some melting, and the structures are not so perfect, and then as a consequence they are not working so well. If you use picosecond laser, on the other hand, so you can see on the left hand side, you can create perfect periodic structures, and sure, then you can afford, for example, making of finer structures, and you can reach better results. Other advantage of our approach is that unlike the trend to increase the repetition rate and to increase the speed of the microprocessing by very fast scanners, we think that better way is to use multi-beam processing. Therefore, there is a significant advantage of high energy picosecond pulses, because we have enough energy to split the beam into several parallel beams, into several beams or several tens of beams or hundreds of beams in the future, and to create multiple structures at the same time. So again, there are two approaches which we can use and which we are testing. You can use either diffractive optical element, and this diffractive optical element splits the beam, and you can see the diffractive structure like that, for example, with some diffractive orders and so on. And you can create a huge number of, for example, holes to a material like you see here. It's, I think, steel foil. Which was used, and we were able to create in one shot 784 holes through the metallic foil. Here, this is other approach we can use. Again, we generate several beams, and we used the multiple beam interference for creating of the structures. So again, it's other approach we are testing, and the results you can see here, these are our results from our laboratory. We created such a structure in a several millimeter thick steel, I think 5 millimeter thick plate of the steel. And yeah, so here the left figure is with 500 microns resolution, the right one with 20 microns resolution. So you can, and here you can see the 5 micron fine structure of the material. So you see with the Perla platform, we can reach excellent results in this multi-beam processing. And yeah, the way to more beams and higher pulse energy is in our opinion, better way than using high repetition rate pulses. When you finally face problems of heat accumulation and melting and or plasma creation or some other processes which are unwanted for this process. Yeah, so the laser which we are using for such application and which was used for creation of this fine structures was our Perla platform. Actually, our commercial platform is based on several years lasting experience with development of the laboratory demonstrators I shown in previous slides. So it actually uses all advantages from the Perla B, Perla C and other laser systems, and also frequency conversion. Typical configuration currently is up to 100 watt. Repetition rate customizable from 1 to 200 kilohertz, pulse energy up to 20 millijoules, or very soon we expect increase of the pulse energy, and wavelength definitely fundamental, which is the wavelength of ytterbium-YAG laser. The system is currently CPA, so it contains a pulse compressor with pulse duration below 2 picoseconds. Typically 1.3 picoseconds. We also offer experimental equipment for the laser system. So the laser can have integrated pulse picker. It can have integrated attenuators, shutters. It's a fully safe laser, so it can be used also in industry. It's compliant with all safety standards. The output is very stable and the beam quality is really perfect, but if it works under some noisy environment. We can also add some active stabilization system, and everything is mounted in a very robust metallic housing. Yeah, and like an extension, we also offer second, third, and fourth harmonics extension, and also, as I mentioned, extension for tunable mid-infrared optical parametric amplifier generating from 1.5 to 3 microns at the output. Yeah, so these are like some typical output parameters I've already shown. And some examples of the customized solution we've already manufactured, or we are manufacturing here at HiLase at this moment. So the typical average power range is from 50 to 100 watt, pulse energy up to 10 millijoules, although we are able to reach higher pulse energy, and repetition rates from kilohertz to 200 kilohertz, and almost all customers want extension to harmonics or to mid-IR. What we are working on now is also coupling of the output to hollow core fiber, so finally we should be able to customize also the Perla system with hollow core fiber delivery to, for example, robotic arm. Yeah, some figures of our Perla commercial platform. So this is the laser system itself. The laser system is, or the thin disk amplifier, it's very compact. It's only this part of that system. But this housing also includes all the experimental equipment, as I said. It's a customized with a pulse picker, which is here, motorized attenuators, safety shutters, distribution of cooling water, preamplifiers, and so on. Yeah, so then the footprint is a bit larger, but everything depends on the customer's need. And this is a photo of the fully automated control system. So the laser has a fully automatic loop for machine safety and human safety. It stabilizes all its parameters by a control PLC. It's monitoring all temperatures, all the parameters. You just set the output power, you set the wavelength, and you can end the repetition rate from a pulse picker, and you can start to work on your application. Yeah, there are some typical or some like test parameters from a customer solution of this commercial platform. So the platform is capable to reach then more 100 watt in average power with the efficiency exceeding 45% optical efficiency with excellent beam quality. We are able to reach 1.5 m square parameter at fundamental wavelength. The power stability here we show 0.22%. However, lately we were able to improve the stability even below 0.2%, and we are improving more. And these are tests of a 60 watt laser output, 60 kilohertz 60 watt laser system. That means the pulse energy here is 1 millijoule. Again, the efficiency in pulse regime is 35%, and output power 63 watts in this case. Similar results we provide from higher energy laser, 10 millijoules. And as I said, this platform can be customized up to 20 millijoules of output pulse energy. Yeah, so this is photo of that Perla 100 regenerative amplifier. I would just mention that not all the repetition rates from the laser systems are possible or achievable for the customization. Because at some wavelengths, there are quite high instability coming from the properties of the laser material itself. So in case of whichever customization it must be discussed with our technicians. And you would definitely offer some solutions in case your request is in a forbidden range. We can offer, for example, high repetition rate and use the pulse picker option, which would tailor the pulse train to your needs. And then you can reach really high energy stability at the output. Yeah, so these are some tests of the energy stability, which is slightly worse than power stability. The power is like averaging in time. The pulse-to-pulse energy stability is really crucial for some applications. So the worst case we can reach is currently 1.13% the mean square stability. We are working on active stabilization, and then we can even improve that number below, significantly below 1%. Yeah, so this is measurement of the histogram of the energy stability, and then the pulse-to-pulse measurement we performed. This is output power stability, again an example of the measurement on a commercial platform. So this is the 0.2% root mean square value of stability. This is zoom to this curve. And the beam quality. So here you can see measurement of typical caustic of this commercial laser platform. So this is a near field beam profile. You see it's really circular. It's very, very good beam quality, perfect beam. And the M square parameter, which is very close to 1.1, and in both direction, horizontal and vertical. So the perfect Gaussian beam has M square parameter 1.0. And from that point of view, 1.1 is almost diffraction limited output beam. So we have not much space to improvement, because even very small lasers, oscillators don't have such a good beam quality. And I think this parameter is crucial for the multi-beam processing. So therefore we reach such good results with the multi-beam processing. Regardless, we use the multi-beam interference or diffractive optical elements. And also for other experiments or for tight focusing, if you use even if you use single beam processing and need tight focusing, it's a crucial parameter, and M square needs to be as low as possible. So with such a perfect beam, you can reach really tiny spots in a focal plane. Output spectrum is typically between 1.6, 1.9 nanometers. So that means the pulses have a potential to be compressed below 1 picosecond. We routinely have 1.2, 1.3 picoseconds, but there is a potential to shorten the pulse to, let's say, 0.9 picosecond in the future. Yeah, the spectral shape doesn't change significantly with the output power. We have two ways of pulse compression in the lasers. As I said, we are amplifying stretched pulses in order to keep a long lifetime of all components. For very low power, we can offer such a bulk compressor, which is very tiny, very robust. But the average output power is then limited because it's a bulk material. So then you suffer from thermal gradients, and actually it's negatively influencing the output pulse shape. So up to, let's say, 50 watt, we can offer such solution. And we can again compress below 2 picoseconds. But for higher average power, we offer such a very stable and robust solution with dielectric diffraction gratings. Efficiency of such a pulse compressor is 98%, up to 98%. So you lose only 2% of the pulse energy by this compression. And we can routinely reach pulse duration 1.2 picosecond at the output of such a laser system. Besides the Perla platform, I would also like to mention that we are developing not only the thin disk platform, but also the other supportive equipment like oscillators. In the past, we've been using some commercial systems, but we were not satisfied with the stability or output parameters. So we were forced, in fact, to start also development of oscillators for our thin disk amplifiers. So this is an example of so-called Go Pico oscillator, which provides several tens of millijoules of average power with 30 or 40 megahertz repetition rate and 20 nanometers broad spectrum. So this is in fact femtosecond laser. After pulse compression, the pulse duration can be around 100 femtoseconds. And also such an oscillator can be sold like a commercial device from Hilace. However, we used these oscillators mainly like oscillator for our CPA platform. To summarize it, so Hilace has a very rich experience in thin disk laser development. We offer lasers from with average power from several watts to hundreds of watts. Plenty of repetition rates, pulse energy up to tens of millijoules, and pulse duration around 1.5 picosecond. We can also offer laser components for laser construction, and we can, what is the most important, we have our own commercial laser platform. Following our laboratory development and using benefits of all laboratory demonstrators, it's a very, very stable, very robust laser with average output power up to 100 watt at this moment. But the customization up to higher average power is also possible. We can customize all the parameters, we can extend it by harmonic frequency conversion or mid-infrared conversion. And in fact, we are opened to discussion with each customer about his needs. And finally, our experimental group can support you also in high-tech applications like surface manufacturing, processing, laser material processing, and so on and so on. So we are your strategic partner for future collaboration. Thank you very much for your attention.